ஹாஃப்னவர் அது மோர் வியூ அகெயின் ஆஃப் கவுன்சிலிங் அதர் மக்கள் பெட் டன் ஆஃப் யூ டூ கவுன்சிலிங் ஆன் வாட் யூ வாண்ட் டு டூ ஆஃப்டர் திஸ் தட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் ஸ்டோரி ஜஸ்ட் எக்ஸ்ப்ளோர் தட் அண்ட் தென் அனதர் ஆஸ்பெக்ட் ஆஃப் கவுன்சிலிங் இஸ் கோல் செட்டிங் ஹவு டு பி செட் கோல்ஸ் ஃபார் த கவுன்சிலிங் நோ யூ ஹேவ் அ ஓவர்வியூ ஆஃப் அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்டிங் ஆஃப் கவுன்சிலிங் சப்போஸ் ஐ ஆஸ்க் டு நாட் டிஃபைன் கவுன்சிலிங் ஹவு டு யூ புட் இட் last 2 days you have actually input some counseling right so if you now look at what is counseling how would you define it
listening
to the other person that forms the key what
facilitating
somebody to either resolve their issues or cope with these issues right two things
right
they are not there to provide solutions to them from our behalf so if you look at the way we define counseling as encouraging and motivating a person right to share his thoughts and feelings that is the first step so that comes in first can you even encourage a person to share his thoughts and feelings so when you say encourage a person to share his thoughts and feelings if the person has directly come to you for counseling why will not he share his thoughts and feelings what do you think will prevent him from doing that I'll come to you because you are a counselor so what will stop me from sharing my thoughts and feelings trust first is trust Do I trust you? Like somebody has told me that go to Ranjini, she is a good counselor, so I come to her. So I don't know whether what I heard is right or not. Right? So trust is an issue. So that's where the confidentiality part comes in. That's why we say keep reassuring the person that whatever you have heard from them will be kept confidential or will be only with you. Others are not going to know about it, and it will not be discussed with others in any manner. So when a person starts feeling, because see, when counseling will come to share some of the most intimate details about their life, right, which they have not shared with any human being. Normally we don't discuss our marriages with outsiders, right, whatever happens between a husband and wife stays with them, we never ever discuss with somebody else, because we know we are going to get a lot of judgment from them, or most of the time they are going to say, it's your problem, you deal with it. Suppose you go to your parents and siblings or somebody, they are going to say, it's your problem, you deal with it. Now that we are married, it's no longer our responsibility. So what's the point in going and telling them? So you kind of suppress all your thoughts about your spouse or your children later. So you really can't go and discuss. And you can't really go and discuss about your children with others. You know, some of the things are really happening. Somewhere we have this feeling that the family honor or the family respect has been maintained. So I can't go and discuss with some of this. So in counseling, that freedom is given to the counselor that they can come and share any details with you. Right? Then they need to do that, they need to have a confidentiality feeling that this is not going to be told to someone else. Whatever I share with my counselor, this counselor is going to respect that and keep it with her. So only then the sharing will happen. So that's why we say give them a confidentiality assurance even right at the beginning. As soon as they come in, you ask them to do a little bit of a rapport building, you ask them where did you come from, how did you come, did you find the place easily? Know what is your education, you ask them things like that, and then you go into the confidentiality part, whatever you want. Now you want to encourage them, to share their thoughts and feelings. So at that point of time you come out and say whatever you want to say. Sometimes they hesitate. You ask them about their educational background, they're willing to talk about it. You ask them about who is in your family, who are the people in your family, they're willing to talk about it. You want to talk them about a little bit of their childhood, they're willing to talk about it. When it comes to the real issues, they will not be willing to talk unless they feel that I can trust this person and I can share. So that's why we say that at that point of time, after you have done a bit of a rapport building, asking them to sit down, do they want a fan, do they want some water and all that you have done, give them the confidentiality statement, because that really encourages them to open up. So look at the first part of the definition of counseling, encouraging a person to share his thoughts and feelings and get an insight into himself. When you share your thoughts and feelings, you automatically begin to introspect and you feel like, is this me, this is what is happening to me, or I can look at my own life in a different perspective. I get a different angle to the whole thing because you are giving me a different kind of a perspective to my own. So you get an insight into yourself, and then the definition says help them to resolve their issues or cope with their issues. Like we discussed even in the first day, there are many issues which do not have solutions, right? It is not because for want of trying, it's not because they're not able to think for the solution. It's just that there are no solutions to issues. So when there are no solutions to issues, you just need to cope with them. So for both, if for resolving an issue, you need to look at how do I resolve this issue. If you can't resolve the issue, then you have to cope with the issue. So for both, you need strength. Right. Unless we empower them to deal with it, it doesn't work. Right. And then the definition of counseling goes into the second phase. If necessary, help them to resolve the issues or cope with the issues. That is where the resolution comes in. Right. So if that is the thing, goal setting will not be necessary for all the time. So Dr. Ali will come and take you through the goal setting process, the empowerment process that we do in the next session. Right. And then we look at the other things of. We have listed a few skills that they, listening skills they have covered. You know that listening is the most important skill. Even if you do not get the other things right, if you can listen to them, if the person can feel that I have been heard or I have been able to pour whatever I have and this person has heard me, he can go back much more relaxed. That itself is that 80% of the counseling is done at the listening level. Right? Then we look at the skill of being non-judgmental. Right? This is the most difficult skill. Amongst all the skills, when you look at it, being listening, you can easily listen to people, you can learn to shut up. Right? We always interfere, we always try to complete the other person's sentences. That's a habit for us, isn't it? We like to show that I can read your mind. Even when you are talking to me, I can tell you mean that. Even before you are thinking, if you are pausing, I would like to complete your sentence to show that, look, I can read your mind. You know, that ego thing comes in. You can learn to curb that. You can say, okay, I am not going to complete your sentence, I am not going to supply the words. You tell me the words. If you are struggling for a word, I'll wait. I'll wait for you to say what you are feeling. Right? Because if I give you a word, if I ask you, oh, are you feeling upset about this? You might say, yeah, I'm feeling upset because you don't want to think. Right? This is the easy thing. This counselor is giving me the word for what I am feeling. Let me say, yes, that's what I'm feeling. Although I may not be upset. I might be feeling guilty about the word. Or I might be feeling very agitated about the whole thing. Upset is a shorter word. It's a every emotion has got different degrees to it. When you say anger, I can be upset, I can be irritated, I can be anger, I can be full of rage, right? It's a whole continuum that goes from something like 1 to 60, on the speedometer it goes like that. So every emotion has got that kind of thing. Sadness. Sadness does not mean that I can be little sad, right? I'm a little upset and a little sad, or I can be depressed. So it can go for everything. Every emotion has got different degrees to it. Right? So when it has got different degrees to it, when I am trying to supply a word to the counselor may grab that word and I might not be allowing them to complete their own sentences. So listening skill, somewhere we can manage to hold ourselves back and allow the person to complete the sentences, to get their thoughts out, get their feelings out. That is easy to develop. Empathy, again, sometimes it's possible, easily possible, because I can, most of the time, suppose you have already gone through a situation like that, it becomes easier for you to empathize. Suppose your daughter, somebody is coming and saying, my daughter is behaving like this. And you already have a daughter who behaved like that earlier to you. You can easily empathize because you've already been in that situation. That becomes easier because empathy comes easily. Or at least we have heard of people, we know people, we have read about husband and wife not getting along. So even if my marriage is working well, somebody comes to me saying, my marriage is not working well, I can still empathize with this person. Non-judgmental becomes a difficult part in the whole thing. Why is that? Why is it so difficult for us to be non-judgmental? The moment we say something, somebody, we have to have our judgments about it. The moment you see, you have seen me on the first day, you have all formed your judgments. Right? Each of you has formed a judgment about the other person also. You just look at them and think, she is a strict person, she is a jovial person, she is like this, she must be a difficult person to get along with. Right? We form these impressions. Non-judgmental becomes the most difficult of the counseling skills because to be judgmental is natural. Right? It's a very natural thing to be. Right? You are trying to unlearn what you have already learned. Right? Being judgmental is a very natural thing. And there's nothing wrong about it. When we say we have to be judgmental, why are we being judgmental? Why is being judgmental such a natural thing for all of us? Because one way it protects us. Isn't it? It has protected us from earlier. Sometimes we have looked at somebody and said, I don't think I want to go near this person. Right? Something about him puts me off. That's our instinct coming in. See, sometimes we feel like I have to trust my instincts. Right? So this person just puts me off because he reminds me of somebody else with whom I had a bad experience. Or he reminds me of somebody who is very short-tempered. So I don't want to go near her. The moment you say you form these judgments based on your past experience. Your past experiences of dealing with people, your relatives, your friends, all this is given you a picture of, I don't want to go near this kind of a person because I can protect myself. So being judgmental has got its reasons for being judgmental. But as a counselor, we say become non-judgmental. Start practicing non-judgmental. And it is not like you can become non-judgmental overnight. You just can't become non-judgmental overnight. It's a continuous practice session. Even after so many years of counseling, still the judgment will come. Right? After years of counseling, after maybe 200, 2000 people, we would have gone through the counseling process. We would have gone through the counseling process for at least 2000 people, but still the judgment will come. The moment I see somebody, I have to be conscious and say, no, I'm not going to be judging them. I'm going to hold my judgment. I want to leave my judgment outside. So that is where non-judgmental becomes so difficult because it's such a natural thing. Right? Out in the world you go, you can't continue to be non-judgmental with everyone around you because you need to protect yourself. Right? In the counseling situation, when you become aware that I am sitting here in the counseling situation, this person is not going to harm me in any way. Right? At that point of time, you say, can you start practicing being little non-judgmental, because that will help you to counsel the counseling, because otherwise there's going to be a wall between you and the counseling. There's going to be a barrier between you and the counseling. You're not going to be able to cross the barrier, because once you make a judgment about this person that she is lying, she is exaggerating her condition, for such a small thing she is coming to counseling. Suppose somebody just comes out and starts saying that, you know, why I just wanted to come and discuss with you about my maid. You know, my maid is like this. You feel like, what is this? She's coming and discussing her maid issues with me. Did she come all the way from Jayanagar to Atinagar to discuss her maid issues? Right? Now you are making a judgment saying that she's going to exaggerate everything. Small things, she's coming all the way. What kind of a person is she? But you have to listen to that maid thing also. Because what happens? Why is she discussing that maid thing with you? Could be she's just testing you. Right? If I discuss my maid thing with you, how will you react? I've got a bigger thing to discuss with you. Right? If you dismiss me as saying, oh, why did you come all the way to discuss the maid thing? I'm feeling like this person is going to judge me. So let me not even open my mouth. But that's why we say that even if it's a trivial issue, in your opinion, in your personal opinion, it could be a trivial issue, but do not dismiss any issue that the counseling comes up. Do not minimize any of the issues of the counselees. Right? Always give full respect to the counselee's issue, no matter how trivial, how silly, or how irrational it appears to be. For them, it is important. Right? If I look, if I discuss my maid issue with you and then you give me that support saying, oh, okay, you want to talk to me about her, I'll listen to you. I'll just say 2 minutes about my maid and I feel like I'm connected with you very well. Now I can discuss my real issues with you. Then I'll say, look, I actually came to discuss about my marriage with you. Right? Because I found that this person supports me even if I tell him something so silly as a maid. Right? So once I build that trust, only then I can actually tell you the real thing. And often in counseling, what happens is, people will not be able to tell you the real issues that's bothering them. Why would that happen? When would that happen? That, would a person actually know the real issues bothering them all the time?
Possible
that they might not know what is really bothering them?
They
might
know.
No, I'm saying that, is it possible that there are situations where a person does not really want to tell the real issues that's bothering them? They can't really express their true feelings to you.
Maybe they are confused to figure out what exactly.
They are confused to figure out what exactly is happening to them. That's one of the reasons why they may not be able to, because the counselors themselves don't know the issues with. What else would prevent them from sharing the real issue or the real feelings with you?
Shyness.
Inhibition.
Judgment.
No, if I tell this person, how will he or she judge me? Let me give you one case study here for this thing. This child, he was, I think, 12th class. Right? He had just finished his 12th class. His dad came and met me. His dad said, my child is in the 12th class. He's going to finish his 12th class. And after 12th, he wants to do commerce. They were from Bangalore. He said, my child wants to do commerce. I said, wonderful. The dad said, I have no problems also with him doing commerce, because anyway, I'm running a business in my family. So let him do the commerce and join me after he does the commerce. I said, okay, what's the problem? He said, the problem is he wants to do BCom, but he wants to go to Delhi to do BCom. He says that he wants to go to Delhi and do BCom. And I am looking at, is he doing some MBBS or some great MBA program that he has to go all the way there? He's doing a small course like a BCom where 100 colleges are there here in Bangalore. But he says he wants to go to Delhi and do BCom. So can you please talk to him? I said, okay, I'll talk to him. when the child came to talk to me, I asked him, "My lord, why do you want to, what is it that makes you want to go to Delhi to study B.Com?" He said, "I had studied in India Today that they had ranked different colleges which are the best colleges, and I found that Shriram College of Commerce is the best college of commerce in India. I want to live in Shriram College of Commerce." What is the real reason? I didn't know. Right? One is like wanting to go all the way from here to Delhi to study B.Com is a totally unheard of thing. And very few people do that. Right? So I needed actually what we call in counseling is unmasking. Unmasking is a phenomenon where we kind of help them to reveal their true issues and true feelings. They are going to something else, but they are putting it up a mask and saying this is what the real thing is. So, as little bit of trained counselors, can you ask me the question to find out my real reason for going to Delhi? I am the child. Right? I am the child, I come to you, you ask me the first question, what makes you want to go to Delhi? I said, I want to study in the Shriram College of Commerce, that's why I am going. Now, as counselors, ask me questions to find out what could be my true reasons.
Do you have any friends
who are going to study there? No, auntie, I don't have any friends there. I can call you auntie. No, I don't have any friends there. I am going alone. All my friends are studying here only in Bangalore. Most of them have joined engineering. They have given the CET exam, they have joined engineering. I am not interested in engineering. So my dad told my dad I want to do commerce. He said, you do whatever. So no, none of my friends are going to Delhi.
So
what
do you think you miss your friends when you go to Delhi
compared to the course? Yeah, I think I'll miss my friends, but I think I'll make new friends also there. Because in any college you go, you'll make new friends. So here, my friends will be there, I'll be in touch with them, we're all friends on Facebook and WhatsApp, we're all in a group. So I'll keep in touch with them, but I think I'll also make new friends when I go to Delhi.
It's great, Sridhar, that you want to study in Shriram College. It is indeed one of the best colleges in India. So have you inquired about the courses and how the environment there? Have you started the process?
No, I just saw it on the net. That they are the best college. I read it in the India Today. Then I went and checked the college campus and all. I think it is quite good. Because if they have been ranked as number one in India, then the college campus and facilities must be good there. So I decided to do commerce. Within that, what subject to take, I am not really bothered with that.
Have you thought about after going, how will you get engaged with, how you will adjust yourself with the environment? Because Delhi is very different, very much different from Bangalore.
Yeah, I think I look at it as a challenge, you know. I think it will be a real challenge for me to go away from the family, stay there, look into making new friends, new places. I'm thinking it's going to be exciting.
What do you miss your family here? Your parents, your siblings?
I've got just one brother. He is much younger than me, so
nothing much.
Don't think of it like that.
Are you going to stay in a hostel?
Yeah, I'm going to be staying in a hostel. Because I don't have any other relatives or anything there, and dad says it's best to stay in, if at all you have to go, you can't stay outside on your own, stay in the college hostel.
So you look forward to staying in the hostel?
Yeah, I think it's a good idea. Okay, I'm going to enjoy this. Something. They are either going towards it because they like it. That's one part. Or they are running away from something which they don't like. Right? So this boy went on insisting that, you know, like my Shriram College of Commerce, we didn't know anything about that place, we didn't know anything about that college. For him, it got stuck that I have to go to Shriram College of Commerce instead. It took me quite a few sessions, you know, two or three sessions to make him discuss about his family. That's how we do. When you say unmasking, can we really uncover the true motivations behind this person? Because unless I can uncover the true motivations, I'm not going to be helping the child. How am I going to helping the child, which is two things. If I know what exactly he is wanting to do, I can say, okay, maybe you can try this or maybe you can try that, we can explore alternatives. So this child, it took me 2 or 3 sessions for him to come out at some point and say, I don't like to stay with my dad. I hate my dad, I just can't stay with him. He is a 24-hour parenting. He is always behind me saying what messages I am sending to my friends. Whom am I talking to? Am I having some girlfriend? Or am I talking to some bad company? He call, when my friends come home, he calls them inside and he talks to my friends. I mean, I am wondering, are they my friends or are they his friends? No, he talks to all my friends. If they are outside, he'll go and talk to them. He wants to listen to the conversations that I have. When I am on internet, he comes and says, who are you talking to, what is going on and all that. So for me, I find it very, very stifling. Right? He is like on me all the time. And I just hate that. Right? I just want the freedom to get away from him. So that's why I said, now look at this statement of a child of 16-year-old or 17-year-old coming and telling you that I hate my dad. Whether he hates his dad or not is different. He hates the certain characteristics of his dad. Right? The situation that the dad has created him, that he hates. But the general tend to generalize it as, I don't want to stay with my dad. I just hate to stay with him because 24/7 he is on me like this. And I just can't breathe anything of my own. Right? The smallest thing I have, he wants to know what happened to that. Did you lose that? Did you buy that? Where did you get the money for buying this? Everything I have to explain to him. If I go out with my friends and come back, he wants to know who are the friends who had come to that place. What did we do in that place? He said, I just don't have any freedom here. Suppose he goes and tells this statement that I hate to stay with my dad, to let us say his uncle, his aunt, or his cousin. What do you think they'll tell you with that? What are the statements he'll get back from all the relatives around him?
He's going for you only.
How can you, first thing is, how can you talk about your dad like this? Right? How can you talk about your dad like this? Your dad is such a great man, we know him so well. Your relationship with the dad is different. He is not hovering around to 24 hours. He is hovering around me for 24 hours. Right? Your dad is such a nice man. He has done so much for the family. He has done so much for you. And you talk to him about like this that you have to stay with him. He is a wonderful man. He is so well known in the society. He has got so much of respect. He has built so much of business. Right? Everybody looks up to him and you should be proud to be his son. And you are saying that you hate him. This is all the lecture, morals, the thing people will give him. So can he really ever express his true feelings? Right? It's impossible for him to come and tell any adult around him that I don't like to stay with my dad. Right? We rever parenthood. We say, oh, dad and mom are my gods. You can't be talking about them in any ill manner. That is nice on a book or it is nice to read or listen to in a discourse or anything of that sort. In real life, if I have a dad like this who is 24/7, I just want to run away from him. Right? So, this child can't really express his true feelings. That's what we say, that being non-judgmental is so difficult that the moment somebody says something like this, I want to say, if I have a son of his age, I'm sitting there for counseling, I've been thinking, is my son also thinking like this? Right? He said he wanted to go to Manipal and study. Is he going because he wants to go to Manipal, or is he going to Manipal because he wants to run away from me? Right? I begin to judge, like, how can he talk like this? My son would never talk like this. Right? I have brought up my son in such a way that I have been very open that my son, we either judge the child or we judge the parent. Right? We begin to think, how can a parent be like this? Right? How can a parent be like this? Because I am not like that. How can a parent be like this?
Always
we are putting ourselves in the place and saying, I will not be like this. Why is he like this? Look at all the issues that we have with people. Every time we look at people, we are saying, why is she doing like that? Which means, in that situation, I would not have done that. Right? I would not have done the same thing what she is doing. So, why is she doing that? I am always thinking, I do the correct thing. Right? I do the perfect thing. I am the perfect human being. Everybody around me is somewhere or the other wrong. So, the judgment comes in because, why is he behaving like that? Why is he acting like that? Why does he talk like that? Because I will not talk. The second line, unheard line is, I will not talk like that, I will not behave like that. Me, I am the perfect. Rest of the world, something wrong with them. Even for the emotions, even for the degree of whatever we get, I am the perfect. I know exactly when to get angry. When I get angry, it is justified. My anger is always justified because I get angry for the right reasons. Everybody around me, this person gets angry too fast, too short tempered. This man doesn't have any ego at all. You can provoke him anything, he doesn't get angry. Me, I am the correct person. I know when to get angry, I know how much to get angry. Right? that's where the judgment comes in, that I am the perfect, rest of the world is not perfect or in any way of that sort. So we always constantly comparing ourselves. So just to complete this part of this child, how do we actually handle him? First he come, it was difficult for him to come and share that I hate my dad, that's why I want to run him. But Delhi had nothing to do with it. Shriram College of Commerce had nothing to do with it. So here the father fortunately was somebody who was willing to be open. Right? If the father is not open at all, if the father says nothing doing, you have to study in Bangalore and not study anywhere else, he wouldn't even have brought him to counseling. Right? If the father had been that kind of an autocratic person, then he said nothing doing, you have to stay here, you have to listen to me only, I am not sending you anywhere for BCom, you are going to go to St. Joseph or somewhere and study here. I am not, if he had been that kind of a father, he would not even have brought him for counseling. The very fact that he brought him for counseling showed that the father was a little bit of open to the idea of discussing how can I help my son or what is it that's happening. So for me, I can't go, I just checked with the son, is Delhi the only thing you want to go or is anywhere else also okay? He said anywhere else is okay except you can put me in Ramnagara, you can put me in Mysore, you can put me anywhere. As long as I'm not staying here, I'm fine. See now, it has come down to the real expression of his feelings and the real motive why he wants to go. So when I talk to the dad, can I tell the dad that your son doesn't want to stay with you because he doesn't like to stay with you? Can I do that? Can I tell him that your son hates to stay with you because you are a helicopter parent or you are 24/7 parent? He is finding staying with you stifling, he can't breathe around you. Can I really tell a dad all that? Right? It's impossible, we can't really tell that. What happens if I tell that? I'm actually going to spoil the relationship between the dad and son. Right? As a counselor, it's important to remember that whether we help the counselee or not, we should not be harming them. Right? I should not make his situation worse than what was before by telling him what to do. That's why we say be non-directive, because one moment you are non-directive, you are allowing the other person to take charge of their life. I am allowing the other person to take responsibilities for themselves. Right? I am not telling them what to do. So when we say be non-directive, that's what we mean. So here what happened was, until that point it was, I had been talking to the son. Once the father came, I had to put it to him in a different way. That today's children, they need a little more freedom. You know how it is with today's youth. They like to have their own bit of a choice of a freedom. So I asked the father, instead of Delhi, can I convince him to be somewhere in Mysore? He said, oh, Mysore is good. That's only, I'm thinking 3 hours, I can go and check my son once in a week at least. So he said, 3 hours, Mysore is okay. I think, why go all the way to Delhi to become? If he wants a little freedom, he can always be in Mysore. So that's how the thing got resolved. The son began to study in Mysore. The father was happy that he can go once a week, or he can call him back to Bangalore once a week and still monitor him. The son got his, but every time such a things don't work out. It will work out only if we have got the support of the parents also into what the child wants. This is what we mean by, can we help the real issues to come up in counseling? Unless the real issues come up, we can't really help the counselor. So that is where our skills as a counselor comes in. Can I really help the person? And that comes in if I be completely non-judgmental, if I be empathetic to the person feels I can trust this counselor, I can tell him the real things, he's not going to judge me. Rest of the world is going to judge me, but here is one person in this world who will not judge me for revealing my true thoughts and true feelings. Right? That is where the skills of counseling comes in. Right? So how do we take it forward? How do we empower that person? And how do we actually set them goals if we need to set a goal in a counseling situation? How do we set goals? I'll leave it to you.